Okay, start this presentation. Okay. I thank Professor Paolo Borghignoli for giving me some room to talk about localized waves in this course. It's great. And I will give this talk of about 45 minutes, let's say, and I will not give too many details about the analytical treatment of these objects that you will find in the slide. But I will try to give you an idea of what are the potentialities of these objects in many electromagnetic issues, let's say. So I will start with a brief introduction about the diffraction and non-diffracting waves. Are basically the main property of localized waves. Then I will
Hello.
Talk a little bit about
Sorry to interrupt you.
Compact complex spectral objects. That means the connection that exists between rays and plane waves that is helpful to understand how radiation occurs from planar aperture in order to create focused beams and focused pulses that are the constituents of localized waves. This will give me the opportunity to talk about compact spatial temporal wave packets. As I said, localized beams and localized pulses and representatives of these objects are Bessel beam waves. And finally, I will draw the conclusion. So, as you know, diffraction is always present in any kind of wave phenomena. And in this seminar, we will try to answer some fundamental questions about diffraction that are basically, if it is really possible to beat the diffraction limit, to push over the non-diffractive limit of waves, if it is possible to focus electromagnetic energy over an arbitrary small region, and if we can do that in any frequency range, in particular at millimeter waves or microwave frequencies. Well, in order to give an answer to the problem, if it is really possible to avoid the spatial spreading of waves caused by diffraction, we can detect this when Stratton actually predicted the existence of an entire class of solutions that do not undergo diffractive spreading as they propagate. These solutions, Helmholtz equation, are basically known as Bessel beams, but later, I would say in the 80s, they belong to a wider class of solutions that, in theory, have diffracting features. This wide class of solutions are namely known as localized waves, and sometimes it is useful to distinguish between two other classes of solutions. Those that are monochromatic solutions that exist for a single frequency, that are Bessel beams, and polychromatic solutions, though I would say solutions that possess a given frequency bandwidth, and these solutions are X waves. Well, now, I would prefer to give an introduction about this terminology about compact spectral objects before introducing the properties of localized waves. And in order to give an explanation of how rays can be connected to plane waves, it is useful to first talk about spectral representation. So in order to have a clear picture to understand radiation from an aperture distribution, it is good to relate the spatial spectral and the plane wave spectral representation. Here you can find this representation in presentation of the field radiated by a linear array of line sources, given as a superposition along the spatial coordinate y of the green functions of this line source distribution along the x-axis. And in red, you have the same representation, a different and alternative representation of the same field with a spectral representation with this sort of integral in terms of the spectral variable eta, that is number to the one. Well, the link between these two interpretations is provided by exploring the plane space spectral expansion of free space green function that is given by this relation here that relates the Hankel function of zero to vertical species to this integral in terms of the spectral variable eta. If you use this representation of the Hankel function here, you can go back from one interpretation to the other. Now, it is interesting to assume a source distribution that is of the following type, an amplitude distribution and a phase distribution that are slowly varying function with respect to the wavelength. And it is useful to have an asymptotic evaluation of these two representation with respect to such an aperture distribution, because the asymptotic representation of these integrals lead to a very interesting geometrical interpretation. Indeed, if we exploit an asymptotic evaluation of these two integrals, and we can do that by exploiting the large argument asymptotic expansion of the Hankel function and by evaluating at the points of this integral, as has been shown in this course, the evaluation of the saddle points of this integral equation gives you a straightforward geometrical interpretation. Indeed, if we evaluate the derivative of the phase term of this integral with respect to the spatial, we obtain this relation here that is just telling us that the main contribution of this integral to the field that is observed at an arbitrary location yz is given by rays that connect with straight lines the part of the source that is contributing to this point selected by the observer. In other terms, is the observer that selects the portion of the source that contributes to radiation. But it is true only when the source can go from A to B, from any point to A to B. But for endpoints that are fixed at the A limit on the left and the B limit on the right, we have that the observer can no longer select the source. And this means that the whole spectrum have this endpoint contribution that excites the whole part of the spectrum. The same interpretation can be obtained if we use the other spectral representation of the field. And basically, you get the same result, even if expressed in a term, by again evaluating the points of this integral here. And these results again links the spectrum to the same geometrical interpretation. And this conclusion closes the loop that basically ray trajectories in the spatial domain are associated to plane waves in the spectral domain. Because here we have that this angle is associated to the spatial angle of the spatial interpretation, while here this angle theta is associated to the spectral angle of the plane wave that is propagating along a given direction. Now we can go a step farther and assume that the phase term that we used in the aperture field distribution is no longer real but can be complex. And this brings you to a different evaluation of the integral, a different asymptotic evaluation of the integral by means of the steepest descent technique and the that you have seen in this course. And if you assume this generally complex phase distribution, the result is that basically you have that the imaginary part that you have added to this phase contribution acts as an exponential taper to the amplitude distribution of this source. And this is actually a practically famous example of a Gaussian beam that is actually a beam that has an exponential taper on the source and is characterized by an imaginary part of the phase that is equal to the square of the spatial variable along the y-axis divided by a terms 2b that is in connection with the dimension of the source. And provided that you use this expression for the imaginary part of the phase spectrum, you have some nice formula that tells you how the diffractive spreading of the beam as it propagates is related to the aperture of the source. And basically, you have that as you propagate at a distance that is called the Rayleigh distance, ZR, you have that the beam width of this Gaussian beam is spread about a factor that is proportional to the square root of 2. Such a complex give rise to saddle points now that cannot be captured if we perform the integration on the real axis. And so we have to analytically extend the real spatial axis to the complex plane. And this can be done by evaluating the steepest descent path over the complex plane, as you have seen in the previous slides of this course. And this opens to a very nice interpretation of this phenomenon of generation of a Gaussian beam from a finite aperture that tells you that basically you can still have a compact spectral representation of this phenomenon if you use a complex source. You can imagine that this Gaussian beam that is generated over a real space that is constituted by the z-axis and the real y-axis is generated by a source that is generated in the over the imaginary axis and gives contribution to the real field generated on the real aperture through complex Rayleigh trajectories. And the same conclusion can be obtained even if we start from the spectral representation. So basically, this last example is basically the analytic continuation of what we have seen in the previous slide in the real case. One interesting application of these methods and of this spatial spectral representation with complex source points is given by a particular wave packet that is known as focus wave modes. Indeed, if we imagine to have a complex source point that is located along the imaginary z-axis, and we have that this complex source point travels over a line parallel to the real z-axis at the speed c, that is the speed of light, we have that this solution no longer generates only a Gaussian beam, but a mode that is focused, that is spatially confined over both the real y-axis and the real z-axis, and propagates without changing its shape. Basically, we have obtained with this particular source that is traveling over the a line that is parallel to the real z-axis but is located over the imaginary z-axis, a pulse that does not suffer neither diffraction nor dispersive spreading because it travels along the real z-axis while maintaining its shape that is narrow along both the y and the z-axis. And as we will see, this particular property of pulses that are confined along both the transverse and the longitudinal direction and travel while maintaining unaffected their shape while they propagate is shared by most of the wave solutions that belong to the class of localized waves. Well, let's, in order to introduce localized waves, it is useful to start from the homogeneous wave equation in time domain. And then to switch this, to put this homogeneous wave equation in a cylindrical reference frame. When we do that, we can apply the Fourier method to obtain a generation of a solution to this differential equation in terms of Fourier or Bessel integrals. In particular, we have an ordinary Fourier transform with the spectral variable to the frequency and to the wave number spectral variable KZ, and also with respect to the spectral variable in terms of Hankel transform because of the cylindrical coordinate transformation. And hence, indeed, here the kernel is a Bessel function of nth order. When we assume, however, an axially symmetric solution, this problem simplifies a little bit. We no longer have the dependence from the azimuthal coordinate, and the integral is given in terms of an ordinary over a Bessel function zero order instead of nth order. And we can still simplify this integral representation of a generic solution of wave in the reference frame if we exploit the separation relation and we enforce the vertical wave number, the wave number along the z-axis to be real, basically by enforcing the key row to be in the radiating region. And if we do that, this integral representation collapses in this one where we have only two integrals, one with respect to the angular frequency omega and the other one with respect to the radial wave number that is now allowed to go only from the minus keynote and plus keynote, that is the visible range because of the hypothesis stated here. And this representation is given in terms of an arbitrary spectrum that depends on both the radial wave number and the angular frequency. So far, this expression is not referring to any localized wave, it's just a solution to the wave equation in a general solution, the wave equation is in the reference frame, while assuming only wave numbers that belongs to the visible range. What we need to have a particular solution of a wave in a cylindrical reference frame? Well, we have to give an expression to this arbitrary spectrum as function of key rho and omega. And if we want a Gaussian beam, that is a monochromatic solution, since it is monochromatic, we will have a Dirac function in terms of the angular frequency variable that fixes the frequencies to be only omega zero, omega naught, a single frequency that we set. And then we have the Gaussian distribution with respect to the key rho variable here. And if we enforce this expression in this integral up here, we obtain the Gaussian beam that can be seen under the paraxial approximation as given in the closed form reported here. On the other hand, we can also have a polychromatic solution, if we allow the dependence from the angular frequency, no longer given by a Dirac function, but again by a Gaussian distribution. And if we enforce this expression in the integral relation reported on top, we again obtain under the partial approximation a closed form expression for this wave function. And the common feature of these two expressions, the one for a Gaussian beam and the one for a Gaussian pulse, is that both expressions reveal the diffractive and dispersive nature of these solutions. So a solution, a generic cylindrical solution in terms of an arbitrary spectrum when the spectra are those of Gaussian type are diffractive and dispersive. So we may ask, what is the source of this diffractive and dispersive nature? And that they have in common both spectra is that the arbitrary spectrum S rho omega is separable in terms of a function that only depends on rho and a function that only depends on the angular frequency omega. And this is why these solutions are diffractive and dispersive. So let's try to define what could mean a non-diffractive and a non-dispersive property for a general solution of this integral relation up here. And we can say that in order to have non-diffractive and non-dispersive property of this generic solution, we want to the wave solutions to be invariant under translation when a certain time has passed. And what amount of time? Well, the amount of time that is required to a wave to travel that distance, that is delta z, with a constant velocity, that is the velocity of the wave itself. This property here is enforcing the rigid transport of the wave along a direction that is the z direction, as we set here. And if we apply the Fourier transform on both sides of this relation, we obtain that this equation, the rigid transport of the wave, implies the fulfillment of the following constraint. Basically, the angular frequency variable needs to have a linear coupling with the spectral variable kz, or maybe it has to be a quasi-linear function, a fine transformation of the variable. And this constraint means that in order to have a localized wave that is non-diffractive and non-dispersive, the spectrum can no longer be arbitrary, but it should satisfy this sort of spectral coupling. And in the following, we will see some examples of spectrum that fulfill this constraint. And we will start for the simplest one that are called Bessel beams. So in order to keep things as simple as possible, we have, a Dirac function that sets the monochromatic nature of the beam. And then we have another Dirac function that enforces this linear coupling between the frequency and this radial, and the radial wave number, as you can see here, because this the argument of this Dirac function has the radial wave number that is coupled to the free space wave number that is a function of the frequency, and an angular variable that here we have called theta naught that has an important role in the property of Bessel beam, and that we will call more generally hexagon angle. Okay, when we enforce this spectrum in the integral relation that we used so far, that is the integral representation of a generic solution of the wave equation in a cylindrical reference frame, we have that this spectrum inserted in this integral relation gives this closed form expression for the wave function that is basically a propagating Bessel beam with an hexagon angle theta naught. And it can be seen that this Bessel beam solution is equivalent to a spectral superposition of plane waves with wave numbers that lie on the surface of a cone with the angle given by the hexagon angle. And this can be understood by looking at the argument of this Dirac function. Indeed, this integral will give you contribution only when the radial wave number is fixed to this value of q naught sin theta zero that fixes the radial wave number to lie on this cone. This is also due for the azimuthal symmetry properties that we enforced here. And the interesting property of this solution is that if you take the modulus of this expression, you can simply see that this solution is invariant with respect to the z-axis. There is no longer dependence from the z-axis. And this is a way to understand the non-diffractive nature of this beam. But now, one should ask, how far can we go in the longitudinal direction? Is it really that this beam can propagate along the z-axis up to infinity? This is what this expression is telling us, because it is an ideal expression. But in a real world, this does not happen. Indeed, the non-diffractive properties of Bessel beams are obtained assuming an infinite aperture distribution. However, in practice, you will never be able to generate a beam with an infinite aperture. So the reason why with an infinite aperture you have a beam that is invariant up to an infinite distance can be interpreted, can be understood looking at the reinterpretation of radiation from the fields. Indeed, as I said in the previous slides, in the first slides, interpretation of radiation from an aperture by making a connection between plane waves and rays. As I said, a Bessel beam is a superposition of plane waves that propagate along the surface of a cone. So we can imagine that if we have an aperture, we will have plane waves and then rays that propagate towards the axis of propagation at an angle theta zero. So if we have these rays from coming from an infinite aperture distribution, it is easy to understand that these rays will have constructive interference along the z-axis up to infinity, because along over an infinite distance, you will always have a ray that impinges on this z-axis. However, if the aperture is truncated, of course, the last emitting rays from the aperture fixes the maximum distance that can be achieved when these rays beat one another in a constructive way. And this geometric interpretation actually gives an approximate formula for the non-diffractive range of a Bessel beam generated by truncated aperture that has a radius that is here called with the symbol rho sub AP, that stands for aperture. And another interesting property of Bessel beams is that this term that is called hexagon angle is also associated to the transverse spot sites of the Bessel beams by this relation here. And basically you have that the ratio between the beam sites and the non-diffractive range, that is a sort of figure of merit that you want to minimize as much as possible, because you would like to have the smallest beam as possible that reaches the farthest distance as possible, is a function of the hexagon angle that goes as the secant of this hexagon angle. So you, in principle, you will have an hexagon angle that is small as possible in order to minimize this this expression and go as far as possible. And of course, The larger is the aperture, the minimum is this figure of merit. So another desirable parameter is to have an aperture that is the largest possible in terms of wavelength. Okay, but now let's see how many ways we have to generate a Bessel beam, because in the previous slide I have shown that we have rays that are emitting towards the center of the structure. But is it this really possible? Well, when you have, for example, a cavity and you excite it from the bottom with a simple source, you will have waves that propagate in the outer direction, and in a cylindrical reference frame, this will be Hankel function of the sequence pieces and order zero, for example. And since you have outward Hankel function, you will have rays that propagates outward from the source, and then you will not be able to focus energy towards the axis of symmetry. But if you enforce a reflection boundary at the edge of this cavity, you will have also a reflected rays that now is an Hankel function of the first species. And the superposition of these two Hankel functions will give you a triangular shaped region where you have a constructive interference of rays and then the generation of a Bessel beam in this region. On the other hand, you have also another possibility to generate Bessel beam from an aperture. And this requires you to have inward Hankel function distribution over the aperture. And we will see next how it is possible in practice to have an inward Hankel aperture distribution in a realistic device. Indeed, if you have only inward Hankel function and you have inward rays emitting from this aperture, you will have that when these rays traverse the axis of symmetry, they switch their behavior from an inward character to an outward character when seen from the other side. And as a consequence, the region where you have a constructive interference of these rays, and as a consequence, a stationary solution that is a Bessel beam, is now this diamond-shaped region instead of this triangular-shaped region that I have shown before. So basically, two ways to create Bessel beams with realistic device, one based on resonant apertures and one based on traveling wave apertures here. Here is a sort of review of some of the progress that has been made for generating Bessel beams, but I don't want to spend much time on this slide. I want just to emphasize that Bessel beams were first discovered in physics, and as you can see, the first realizations with annulated slits or hexagon ingots sort that to date back to the early 90s or the end of the 80s, while the early generation in the microwave range date back just to less than 10 years ago. And the main reason why there is this temporal gap in this experiment is due to the fact that Bessel beams were really generated under the partial approximation that had to be met at microwave frequencies. So let's see an example of a Bessel beam launcher, that is a device that is capable to generate Bessel beams by means of a resonant cavity. In order to generate such Bessel beams, we can basically generate, have a circular cavity that has a reflection at the boundary realized by a metallic circular rim. And in order to allow for radiation, we have to put on top of this cavity a partially refracting strain that allows for radiation. We can model the structure with the transverse equivalent network, and we can show that this structure is actually capable of generating Bessel beams, as is shown here, where you can see the measurements of this device that has been fabricated in Rennes, in the University of Rennes, some years ago. And here you have some pictures of the near field measurement setup, and these fields are actually measurements of the fields, and you can recognize the annular shape behavior of the Bessel beams when looked from the top, and the non-diffracting behavior of the beam when looked from a front plane. Okay, let's now switch to the part that is related to X waves. So as we have seen before, basically X waves are the polychromatic version of Bessel beams. So if you allow the frequency spectrum to no longer to be a direct function, but more complex distribution, you obtain an X-shaped pulse. Generally, if this spectrum is everything but a direct function, and this is basically can be put as a frequency weight that you have over the frequency for Bessel beams, and if the choice to have an exponential taper of the weight of this frequency spectrum, the ordinary active, and actually if you use this kind of spectrum in this expression, you are also able to have a closed form expression for this ordinary X wave. However, technically, X-shaped X waves regardless of the type of frequency spectrum. So whatever this here, you always call the solution an X wave. Any spectrum provided that is not a direct function, otherwise we will call it a Bessel beam. Okay, the interesting property of an X wave with respect to the Bessel beam solution is that it is not only focused along the transverse direction, but also along the longitudinal direction, the z-axis, that is the axis where proposed. And in particular, it's interesting to know that if you assume to have the simplest frequency spectrum that you can imagine, that is a window function with an extension that gives the bandwidth of the spectrum, that basically uniform frequency speed constant, or say delta omega and zero elsewhere, you are not able to find a term expression for the entire equation, but you are able to find simple expression to evaluate the longitudinal spot size that is reported here, and tells you that the longitudinal spot size is inversely proportional to the fractional bandwidth. This is a very interesting property because it means that in principle you can squeeze the beam along the longitudinal z-axis as much as you want if you enlarge the frictional bandwidth of the pulse. And the other interesting property is that the transverse spot size of an X-wave is inherited from Bessel beams, is the same expression that you have for Bessel beams. And this can also be inferred from the fact that actually the X-wave solution is basically a weighted spectral superposition of Bessel beams that share the same hexagon angle. Well, now let's see what we need to do in order to define better the property of X-waves. Indeed, since an X-waves is localized on both the radial and the longitudinal direction, you can define a sort of localization in a two-dimensional localization along the z-axis and localization along the transverse axis. With respect to the transverse axis, you can define simply a figure of merit, that is how much the beam is large with respect to diameter. But what about the longitudinal axis? Well, the most common way to define a sort of figure of merit on the longitudinal axis is to compare the longitudinal spot sites with respect to the non-diffractive range, because beyond the non-diffractive range, the pulse will no longer be confined. And this brings us to define these confinement ratios that are basically the ratio between the transverse spot sites and the aperture diameter and the longitudinal spot sites divided by the non-diffractive range. Since we have approximate analytical expression for these variables, we are also able to give analytical expressions for these confinement ratios. And we, in order to have a single figure or merit, we can combine these confinement ratio in a single figure of merit that we call C rho Z, that is said to be the product of these two confinement ratio. And we can say that is one when that the maximum of these two confinement is greater than one. That means if the pulse is not confined in one of the two directions, at this point, the wave is no longer confined. So it has to be confined along both direction in order to say that is confined. And if we report this figure of merit in a contour plot where we have this figure of merit function of the aperture size on the x-axis and the hexagon angle on the y-axis, we obtain this figure that shows the boundaries where we can see that the beam is the pulse is confined or not confined. The brighter the color, the more confined will be the pulse. In the dark region, the either is not confined along the right direction or the longitudinal direction, or even both directions. Examples of this is provided here. If you generate a pulse with an aperture radius of about 20 from an hexagon angle of 20 degrees, you will have this pencil-like X wave that is extremely confined on both directions. If you move here where the color starts to get darker, but is still in the confined region, you still have a beam that is confined, but is a little bit broader than the previous one. If you place your pulse with parameters in this region, it will be confined only along the longitude, only along the transverse direction, but not confined along the longitudinal one. Here, in this quadrant here, it will be confined only along the longitudinal direction, but not the radial one. And finally, here, it will no longer be confined along both directions. So you will say that you don't have an efficient X-wave that is not useful for applications. However, all these results have been obtained assuming that the fractional bandwidth is about 20%. But what is the effect of the fractional bandwidth? Well, if we assume to have almost a Bessel beam, let's say a fractional bandwidth of just 1%, you can see that when we evaluate the figure of merit, that is only a very narrow region where you can get confinement, because a Bessel beam is confined only along the transverse direction, as you can see here. So you cannot say that the pulse is confined, because you have confinement only along the radial direction, but it's almost constant along the Z direction. But if you start to increase the fractional bandwidth, what happens is, as I said in the first slides about the property of X, you will squeeze the pulse along the longitudinal direction. And this is what is represented by the animation here. But you can see that after a given point, a point is reached where there are not much differences on the X-ray, so there is no point in having such a large fractional bandwidth of the pools because their property are not affected much after a certain point that we said is about 20, 30. Okay, one thing that I should point out at this stage is that all this, assuming an ideal X waves where the X icon angle does not change with frequency, that is called a non-dispersive ideal X waves. However, especially when we try to generate this wave at the microwave frequency, wave number frequency dispersion has not to be kept. And if we assume that there could be a wave number frequency dispersion effect, also the X icon angle by means of this rate has, and then we will have cone dispersion that will cause the pulse some dispersion along the propagation. However, it can be proven that if this dispersion is not much prominent and you fall in a so-called weakly dispersive case, you can still be able to have an almost focused X waves that maintains its non-diffractive property along propagation. This is the story of X waves as for Bessel beams, and basically there is the same epilogue, I would say, well, where you have the early realizations in physics that occurred in the 90s, while it has been more X waves just few years ago, the experiment of X waves at microwave frequency occurred. First one by the group of Tony Gurbich in Michigan in 2018, and few years later by me and Dr. Coyne in 2018, here with the help of Professor Burgignoli, and Alessandro Galli, and Simon Podilchak, a colleague of us that is in the University of Edinburgh, that a great contribution for the experimental validation of this device. And here I just want to show techniques to generate X waves, because as you can imagine, you can no longer use resonant aperture because you need to have a considerable fractional bandwidth to have an efficient pulse. So you can only resort to aperture that are have two ways to generate such apertures. What can be done by using radial line slot arrays, and is to use an outward angle wave distribution, but excite a backward periodic aperture. I don't have time to give much details about the have a backward way by exciting an aperture with a simple source that excite output angle wave, but this can be done by means of the leaky wave interpretation of the radiation from the structure. So basically you have these two ways to generate X waves with traveling wave aperture distribution, and you can I can skip this slide that talks about the property of both RLSA and the leaky periodic in out of time. I want to show you an animation that shows you how you can actually design one of these devices. Basically, you have you fix some design parameters such as the operating frequency, the aperture size, the X icon angle, the maximum dispersion of the X icon angle that you want within the bandwidth that here is fixed to a fractional bandwidth of 20%. And as a consequence, you will have a non-diffractive range that here is dictated by this choice to be on the order of 120 wavelengths. Well, this choice put you in this plot just here, and as I said, this is the plot of the confinement figure of Mary that is telling us that we are expecting to have a very confined X-wave. And indeed, if we look at along the frequency domain, we can see that as the frequency is changing, you have some of different property that have been generated along the frequency, and since the beam is changing a little bit its shape, we can expect that we will have some dispersion in the generation of the X-wave. This is actually what we obtain. You can see that as long as the pulse is traveling within the non-diffractive range, it maintains its shape, but when it goes beyond this distance, it starts to spread and to decrease its amplitude because of energy conservation. So this concludes my presentation. I hope you enjoyed it. I have talked a little bit about the connection between plane waves and rays to give a geometrical ray optics interpretation of the radiation from aperture. And this gave me opportunity to talk about diffractive beams of the Gaussian type and non-diffractive beams with specific attention that can have a lot of application in the microwave range thanks to a focused and non-diffractive character. So thank you for your attention. Here you can find some references if you are interested to have more details about what has been discussed in this seminar. And if you have any question, please do not hesitate to ask now or to write me an email. Thank you.